Thanks to the IBC, Pak Om, Pak Agung, Pak Luhur. So nice of you to also come early in the morning today. It's really a great honor and privilege for me, and my wife, LPC, my colleague Francis, for all of us from the embassy here to be here in Bandung, beautiful city, to meet our friends from Singapore as well as our friends from Indonesia. I've been asked to talk about an overview by a foreign diplomat about doing business in Indonesia. Now, as many of you will tell you, it's always a big criticism of those of us in government, that government officials only know how to spend money, not to do real business and not to make money. I don't know whether that's a valid criticism, but certainly I will not try to pretend that I'm an expert about doing business in Indonesia or anywhere in the world. But what I will try to share with you are some of my impressions about what I see happening on the economic front, business front in Indonesia, as well as what I think all of us should be doing, those of us in Singapore, as well as those of us in Indonesia. This is my second assignment in Indonesia. I was here before, from 1995 to 2000, and if you will recall, those were the years where Indonesia was going through a very challenging period. But if you had told me that when I returned to Indonesia 12 years later, in June 2012, 12 years later, this is the Indonesia that I will see, very strong and very strong foundations on a very, very sound footing. So I think that is something that is very, very remarkable, and not many countries would have been able to do that. People always ask me when I'm here this time, what is it that you can notice which is very different from the last time? Yang pertama itu immediately I have to say macet. Yeah. When I left Jakarta in 2000, I was telling myself, wow, I don't think the traffic can get any worse than this. But I'm impressed. Indeed, the traffic is more difficult now, 12 years later, than it was then. But I think this is not a criticism, to be honest. I think it's a sign again about the extent to which the Indonesian economy has stabilized and grown in a relatively short period for a very big country like this. So yes, it is a challenge that has to be overcome, but it also shows that the economy is continuing to grow. Now, what about the Singapore-Indonesia economic or business relationship? Now, a survey by the Singapore Business Federation in 2011-2012 has shown that for Singapore business people, consistently over a period of time, Indonesia is always among the top three investors. No matter what the attractions are in other parts of the world, be it China, be it India, the Gulf, the United States, Europe, or traditional areas of economic interest, but Indonesia will always be in the top three. And it is one of the first places that Singaporeans will consider when they go forward. When they venture out of Singapore. Of course, there are a lot of push and pull factors for this. But the major pull factor for Indonesia is that we see very strong and stable economic growth here over a period of time. For example, as of October 2010, not too long ago, Indonesia has undergone consistently 9 consecutive quarters of economic growth, which is above 6%. So it has registered 6.5% in 2011, 6.2% in 2012, and this year also projections are that Indonesia will be around 6% growth as well. Of course, there are many people who will say, well, Indonesia is growing at 6%, that's great. Tapi seharusnya it should be growing at 9%, 8%, something like that. But I think, again, for someone who has been in Indonesia for some time and seeing how big and complicated this country is, I think we have to put things in perspective. It is very encouraging to note that in the last 3 years, Singapore has been the top investor in Indonesia. So in other words, this shows that clearly we in Singapore also recognize the potential of Indonesia and we want to build on this. And I hope we will build on this because bilateral trade today stands at something like nearly 80 billion Singapore dollars, and I think it's poised to grow. there is potential for growth. Many people today ask whether this growth that you see in Indonesia in the recent years, is it sustainable? Is it just something that is a flash in the pan that, you know, when we have a change in government here after 2014, maybe the growth will not be so good. Maybe the foundation that Indonesia really is poised to grow further. Some people will point to the politics. Every day they open the newspapers, watch TV, and they see a lot of negative news about political, politics-related developments in Indonesia. But again, for me as an observer, comparing what I see in Indonesia today about the politics, comparing that to the politics of Indonesia when I left. Now, when I left Indonesia in 2000, I had seen two elections. Pemilihan umum yang terakhir, Order Baru, the last elections of the new order period, and Pemilihan umum pertama, era reformasi, the first elections of the reformasi period. When I compare those elections, especially the elections of the first election of the reformasi period, to the build-up to the elections which we are going to see next year, and some of the local elections that we are already seeing this year, what strikes me is that in those days, elections were all about human rights, democracy, freedom. People were very emotional. People were very destructive, you know, because there was a lot of pent-up frustration, unhappiness, because of the political situation as well as the socio-economic challenges. When people in those days looked ahead, they did not see a good future for themselves and for Indonesia. But today, the situation is completely different. The politics today that you see, in terms of what ordinary Indonesians are concerned about, are things like jobs, inflation, wages, healthcare, sanitation, water, the environment. In other words, these are concerns and issues which all of us face all over the world, even in Singapore. So Indonesia and Indonesians, even in their politics, are beginning to face ordinary problems, ordinary challenges that those of us are facing. And I think a second very important trend that none of us, I think, especially those of us from Singapore, should forget, is that Indonesia is one of the fastest urbanizing countries in the world. The rate of urban development in Indonesia is absolutely staggering. World Bank estimates that within a decade or two, 60-70% of Indonesia's population will be living in urban centers, which can be clustered as cities which are less than 5 million, 5 to 10 million, 10 million and above. Now, for those of us from Singapore who have been living in an urban setting all our life, this may be, you know, so what's the big deal about that? But if you look at Indonesia, if you look at its country, its socio-economic structure, you will realize that this is a massive phenomenon. Which means that for a country like Indonesia, it will be facing challenges of urbanization that we in Singapore have taken for granted, we in Singapore have managed. Which therefore means that there are a lot of opportunities for those of us in Singapore to participate in this rapid urbanization process in Indonesia, to contribute in terms of our experiences, in terms of sharing our ideas, whether it's waste management, whether it's water, whether it's sanitation, healthcare, I think, or public transportation, I think there are a lot of experiences that we can share with our friends in Indonesia, and I think in turn this will provide a lot of business opportunities as well for our friends in Indonesia to work together with our friends in Indonesia for mutual benefit. Now, even as Indonesia makes steady progress, I think we need to be very realistic and pragmatic about what is doable and when it is doable. For those of us in Singapore, if we look at other countries, countries especially complicated like Indonesia, with the Singapore lens, I think you will always find a lot of things to ask questions about or even criticize. So I think it's not a fair comparison. What I think is always coming up in my discussions with friends, whether they are foreign investors or whether they are even the business community here in Indonesia, is to highlight some of the challenges that those of us coming from the outside and who want to do business in Indonesia will need to be aware. First of all, there will continue to be infrastructure bottlenecks in Indonesia. This will take some time to resolve. Logistics costs in Indonesia are indeed very high, transportation costs very high, and Without bringing down these costs, I think it will continue to be a challenge in some business sectors. Second, developing human capital. This goes down to the education system, this goes down to human resource training and development as well on the business side. This is also something that will be a very challenging process in Indonesia and will take some time. Thirdly, of course, I also hear very often comments about the regulatory and policy framework in Indonesia, rule of law, governance, introduction of non-tariff barriers in some sectors. These are all the usual points that will come up. So, anywhere in the world to do business, clarity of business rules, clarity of investment rules, being able to find adjudication or arbitration to resolve problems, these things are very important. And for Indonesia as well, this is a challenge that will have to be overcome. So the challenges that Indonesian economy faces going forward are indeed real, they are indeed formidable. But I think those of us who face problems in life will know that the first step to overcoming challenges is to be aware of these challenges, to even recognize that these are challenges that have to be dealt with. And I think in the Indonesian context, I can say with all honesty that people are increasingly aware of these challenges, and the desire to take action to solve them is indeed getting stronger. And in the government as well, I think with each successive government, the necessary mechanisms are very slowly but surely being put in place to try and deal with some of these challenges. But for again, for friends who come from the outside, like Singapore as well, I would say that we will need to be patient to recognize that the changes that are needed are of a big, large magnitude, and this will take time. I think one other key message that I want to leave with our friends in Singapore who are here today is that in dealing with a country like Indonesia, wanting to do business here, to wanting to develop mutually beneficial cooperation, the key is to develop a good working relationship with your local partners. In other words, whether you succeed and fail in Indonesia ultimately will depend on the local business partners that you choose. Now, I don't just mean choosing a capable business partner or a high-profile business partner. It is very important to choose a local business partner who is on the same page with an investor from Singapore in terms of how they want to see the business evolving, the direction the business is going to take, the pace at which the business is going to evolve, and lastly, what is the end goal, what is the objective of this business venture. I think it is very, very crucial to be on the same page with the local investor on these key aspects. If there's a failure on any of these key aspects in terms of sharing the same viewpoint, I think it will be very difficult for the business to succeed. But I think, again, I want to emphasize the key would be to having a good relationship with the local partner, to be able to build a relationship which is not just about sending a letter with no signature, perhaps, but I think more in terms of having a strong personal relationship with our Indonesian partners. I think this is very, very critical. This is something that I think needs a lot of time and patience, which sometimes those of us in Singapore who are always very pressed for time and who are always very bottom line driven, something that we constantly need to remind ourselves when doing business in a big and complicated country such as Indonesia. I think also one of the key trends that those of us from Singapore will need to take note of is the regional autonomy which is developing in Indonesia. In other words, the decentralization. Dulu, when I was here the first time, my first assignment, you know, business people came to Jakarta, they made their deals here, and then they just go to the regions to see through the implementation. But I think whatever you secure in Jakarta is good enough to be implemented on the ground. No longer is that the case. Today, with regional autonomy, a lot of the action, a lot of the decisions are taken in the regions themselves. So for those of us from the outside, from Singapore for example, we need to be aware of the trends, developments that are taking place in other parts of Indonesia. Not just what is happening in the big cities like Jakarta for example, And again, this is something that will take some time to develop. And I think at the local level as well, people are beginning to grasp what is needed to come up with sustainable growth. They are not just into short-term, incremental, or rent-seeking kind of projects. So all the more, it is very important for those of us to understand what is happening in the region. But I think that's about all this stage I think I can share with you from my experience, because I don't want to take up your time. We have a lot of important discussions, networking to take place. We have other very impressive speakers to hear from. And most of all, as I looked at your program, I saw that indeed, there's a lot of time for networking and building relationships. So I hope you will use the time wisely and make the relationships that are needed for all of us to go forward. Sebelum saya selesai, Pak, mungkin just a few words in bahasa Indonesia untuk teman-teman dari Indonesia. Saya sebagai diplomat yang sudah kerja di Indonesia, mungkin ini yang kedua kali yang saya ditugaskan di sini. Saya dan istri saya sangat senang bahwa untuk berada di Indonesia, karena memang Indonesia adalah satu negara yang sangat-sangat unik di pengalaman kami. Very, very unique in many ways. Dan kadang-kadang teman-teman dari Singapura, dari luar, ada kesulitan atau bagaimana ya mengerti satu negara yang sangat unik begini. Ya. Orang-orang yang Jawa itu ya kelihatannya beda loh dengan orang-orang dari Makassar atau dari kawasan timur. It's very difficult to understand. So harapan saya adalah bahwa teman-teman dari Indonesia ini akan membantu dan mendorong teman-teman kami dari Singapura ya untuk mempelajari dan untuk pengertian mereka apakah tren-tren dan development-development yang ada di Indonesia ini. Dan saya yakin bahwa kalau ada pengertian hubungan baik begini, makin lama hubungan antara Singapura sama Indonesia ini akan makin memperkuat. Ya, that's it very much. Thank you very much and all the best.